بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أن سعيه سوف يرى ثم يجزاه الجزاء الأوفى وأن إلى ربك المنتهى وأنه هو أضحك وأبكى وأنه هو أمات وأحيا وأنه خلق الزوجين الذكر والأنثى من نطفة إذا تبنى وأن عليه النشأة الأخرى وأنه هو أغنى وأقنى وأنه هو رب الشعرى وأنه أهلك عادا الأولى وثمود فما أبقى وقوم نوح من قبل إنهم كانوا هم أظلم وأطغى والمؤتفكة أهوى فغشاها ما غشى فبأي آلاء ربك تتمارى هذا نذير من النذر الأولى أزفت الآزفة أزفت الآزفة ليس لها من دون الله كاشفة أفمن هذا الحديث تعجبون وتضحكون ولا تبكون وتضحكون ولا تبكون وأنتم سامدون فاسجدوا لله واعبدوا.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم والحمد لله رب العالمين حمد الشاكرين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Dear brothers and sisters, wherever you might be. This is the sixth part of Surah An Najm that we started a few weeks ago. And we continue to discuss the meanings and the tafsir of the Quran according to the revelation of the Quran in the sequence of revelation. And we said time and time again that this method of tafsir is rather new. We are not bringing any new tafsir. Okay, assalamu alaikum one more time, dear brothers and sisters, and sorry for the technical difficulties, but I'm resuming now. So the again, one more time, this is the part number 6 of the tafsir of Surah An Najm, and as I have said, this is the tafsir in the sequence of revelation which we are following, and we talked about why we chose and selected the sequence of revelation. It's really to find out how this Quran in the revelation, ayah by ayah, surah by surah, was able to deliver an ummah to be the best ummah ever delivered for mankind, hoping and praying to Allah Azza wa Jal that we will be able to be delivered one more time to bring this light of Islam for the entire humanity as much as it is for the Muslims. And this surah that we are talking about, it's a very important surah, because it really talks about issues, very significant issues related to the aqidah, starting from the first ayah that talks about the falling of a star and correlating that falling of a star to the issue of guidance. And remember that the people in the desert in Mecca, even today, they continue to use the stars or the navigation to navigate their ways. And what if this navigator fails? What if this star falls down and can no longer provide you guidance? What if the idol that you worship, or the king that you worship, or the president, or the system, or the capitalism, or democracy, what if it collapses? And it does. And we have seen how socialism collapsed. What are you going to do? You are going to look for another star or for another system, but why don't you follow the one and only one God, Allah Azza wa Jal, who never falls, who never ends, who does not have a beginning, does not have an end. He's eternal and he's there all the time. And that's why Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is on the complete guidance from Allah Azza wa Jal. And we talked about the very famous journey of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasallam that he took to Al-Quds in the Isra, and then to the Mi'raj, to see and to experience firsthand the issues that he is talking about, or he is listening to, about the ghaib, about the Jannah, about Jahannam, about the angels, about the Malaika, and about all of these issues. Then the Quran talks about, on the contrary, that the gods that you guys worship other than Allah Azza wa Jal, these are nothing but names that you call them gods, you call them elites, you call them authorities. They don't have any authority. They don't have any power over you. They should not be worshipped. These are just what you are, these are your wishy-washy thoughts that make them, that give them these titles or these authorities. And then in the midst of these, Allah Azza wa Jal talks about the claims that Kuffar Mecca used to say, that oh, we do have some entities that will permit us to go to Jannah and to be excused and to be pardoned. They will be able to provide the pardon for us from the atrocities that we have committed. And Allah Azza wa Jal, of course, says this is not true, this will never happen. There is no one, not even the angels, who have the ability to provide this type of pardoning, until and unless Allah Azza wa Jal gives a specific one an authority and asks him to work on behalf of certain people. And then Allah Azza wa Jal in this surah also talks about that category of the ones who really stand up against Islam, those who really stand up against the words of Allah Azza wa Jal, those who want to deny the power of this ayah, the power of the Quran, and the message of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where in ayah number 33 says, just look at the one who runs away and who turns his back against the dhikr, against what Allah Azza wa Jal has given, and all he has is something little in his hand, and whenever he spends any of that, then he feels exhausted, tired. He cannot keep up with the responsibilities, with the issues that he thinks he should. وَأَعْطَى قَلِيلًا وَأَكْدَى. And last time, we talked about a specific issue, which is very important, which says, وَأَنْ لَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى. Look, at the end of the day, each and every one of the people, each insan, each man, each woman, each son of Adam, is going to be responsible for only his own deeds, his own work. He has nothing but his deeds. So don't count on XYZ to forgive you or to intermediate between you and Allah Azza wa Jal. And وَأَنَّ سَعْيَهُ سَوْفَ يُرَى. And you will see your own deed, will make it visible for you, and then that's what you will get. You will be rewarded or punished based on what you have done. Okay, today I will continue with the ayah right after this. وَأَنَّ سَعْيَهُ سَوْفَ يُرَى. In fact, these are the last two ayat we talked about. وَأَلَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى. A man has only whatever he has did. That's what his own deeds. He's responsible for his own acts. No one is going to be responsible for you. And the previous ayah, أَلَّا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَى. No one is going to carry the responsibilities and the sins of other people. You are charged with authority, with responsibility. You better bear that responsibility. You have this message, you have your deeds, you commit atrocities or you commit something good, that's what you will get. ثُمَّ يُجْزَاهُ الْجَزَاءُ الْأَوْفَى. And then يُجْزَاهُ الْجَزَاءُ الْأَوْفَى. The reward or punishment is going to be complete. You will not miss any part of your deeds. In fact, there is another place in the Quran where it says, the kuffar, whenever, or the kuffar and the people in general, whenever they see their books, the books of deeds, they would be so shocked. ما لهذا الكتاب لا يغادر صغيرة ولا كبيرة إلا أحصاها. Wow, this book of deeds did not leave behind anything, small or big. No matter how much you valued that deed or you regretted it, whether it's small or big, it's going to be there, and it's up to Allah Azza wa Jal to take care of you, either in reward or in punishment based on your deed. وَأَنَّ إِلَى رَبِّكَ الْمُنْتَهَى. The next ayah, it says, وَأَنَّ إِلَى رَبِّكَ الْمُنْتَهَى. It is up to Allah Azza wa Jal going to be the end of ends. Everything ends with Allah Azza wa Jal. Everything ends in front of Allah Azza wa Jal. No matter, and that's very crucial. Remember that this surah is still one of the earlier surahs. It lays down all the issues that are going to face you. So Allah Azza wa Jal does not keep up things hidden or unknown or not provided to the people. Whatever you do, whatever you live, whatever life you have, whatever things you think of, or games you play, or atrocities you commit, or positions you take against Islam or pro-Islam, against the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal, or pro the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal, all of it is going to reach its and final end will be Allah Azza wa Jal. وَأَنَّ إِلَى رَبِّكَ الْمُنْتَهَى. All will lead to Allah Azza wa Jal. It's not even to angels. He is not talking about the books of deeds, which are also facts. But here, in this dramatic way, it is you will end up directly in front of Allah Azza wa Jal. So those who stand up against Allah, those who deny the right of Islam to rule or to exist or to be in power or to be in charge or to run the affairs of the people, eventually you will stand in front of Allah Azza wa Jal, who owns this deen. Inna ad-deena 'inda Allah al-Islam. This deen that you are opposing, this deen that you are rejecting, this deen that you are separating from the life of the people, is the deen of Allah. It's not my deen. It's not Abu Talha's deen. It's not Faizan's deen. It's not even Muhammad's deen. It's not the deen of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's the deen of Allah. Inna deena عند Allah. The deen for Allah azza wa jal is the Islam. It's his deen. It's his message. It's his guidance that he provided. Now, if you take stand against that, you have to wait and you will see that one day you will end up in front of Allah azza wa jal. وَأَنَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ الْمُنْتَهَى. Who is this Rabb that you will end up in front of? Now, we talked about in the previous three surahs that we discussed before, Surah An Najm, Surah As-Samad. Who is this Allah that you are you will end up in front of him? In Surah As-Samad, he says, أحد الصمد لم يلد لم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. Then Surah Al-Falaq, Surah Al-Falaq, رب الفلق, the Rabb of the creation of all of this universe. In Surah An-Nas, رب الناس ملك الناس إله الناس. This is Rabb, and here it says, it's to that Rabb that we talked about in the previous surah you will end up. And to add more to this scene, if you will, to this dramatic scene, that you end up in front of the one who is وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ أَضْحَكَ وَأَبْكَ. He is the one who really makes you laugh and smile up to the end, or at that time at the end, because in this life you may laugh for something that's not laughable, you may cry for something that's not to be cried about. Here he says it's Allah Azza wa Jal who will make each and every one who stands in front of him either laugh, smile, be happy, or cry, whine, be sad, and be and regret the fact that he is in this position. وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ أَضْحَكَ وَأَبْكَ. And there is here a series of describing this, let me call it this entity, this God, this creator, this almighty, that you will end up in front of him. You end up in front of the one who has the final say to you, whether you will laugh or cry, whether you will smile or whine, whether you will be happy or sad. وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ أَضْحَكَ وَأَبْكَ. وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ أَمَاتَ وَأَحْيَا. He is the one who created death and life. He is the one who took your life away. He retrieved the soul from your body, and therefore you died. He is the one who did that, and he is the one who gave you life in the first place. So if you are not sure where are you ending up, because sometimes you say, oh, I'm ending up, I have a court sue against me, someone is filing charges, and your lawyer warns you, he says, you know, you are ending up in front of a judge who is very serious, who does not make any jokes, he gives harsh sentences, or he gives a release, a relief if you are innocent. So the one you are standing in front of is one of the most serious, significant judges in this whole judicial system. And this is more. I'm sorry to make that comparison, but trying just to give you a view of what is this stage that Allah Azza wa Jal is setting for you whenever you go back. After he said that, look, you are going to be treated completely with complete transparency. No one is going to carry your sin. Don't count on that. You will see your deeds. Your deeds are going to be in front of you, and you will be rewarded, and you will stand in front of Allah Azza wa Jal. It's the final of the finals, the final step in this whole journey. From the time you became alive, you had your life, until you reach that end, it's Allah who did it. It's to Allah, and he is the one who has the final authority and judgment to make someone happy or eventually eternally sad. who will laugh and smile and be absolutely joyful and has the ultimate joy, or to have the ultimate whining and being sad. It is the same one who provided life and provided death. It's the same one. وأنه, in the next ayah, وأنه خلق الزوجين الذكر والأنثى. He is the one who created the couples, the male and female, this male-female system that Allah Azza wa Jal created. Is the and that is part of your joy in this life. You have enjoyed in this your in life being female or male, with marriage or without marriage, those who marry according to the rules of Allah Azza wa Jal, or those who commit sins against the rules of Allah Azza wa Jal. It's Allah Azza wa Jal who created this coupling system between and the dual genders, whether it's in the animals, in the plants, in the for the humans, but he's talking about the humans here. He is the one who created this system that you enjoyed while you were alive. You enjoyed being a man or a woman. You enjoyed your instincts, your joy, your joyful acts whenever you had this meeting between both couples. But remember, if had you conducted yourself in a manner that does not please Allah Azza wa Jal, or that goes against what Allah Azza wa Jal permits or allows, then you will face that God who made the rules on how these couples are going to conduct, should conduct themselves. So although it's my instinct that Allah Azza wa Jal created, it's my male hormones or liking, it's my female likings or hormones, but it's Allah Azza wa Jal who created them. He has created this coupling system, and you chose to either follow the guidance of Allah Azza wa Jal, or you chose to go against the guidance of Allah Azza wa Jal. You will meet Allah Azza wa Jal anyway, and he's the one who would make you happy and smile, or will make you sad. He created all of these من نطفة إذا تمنى. من نطفة إذا تمنى, this is from the sperm of the man, that once it departs the body of the man and goes to the womb of the woman, then that's how the creation happened. وَأَنَّ عَلَيْهِ النَّشْأَةَ الْأُخْرَى, and then continues Allah Azza wa Jal, and the next life after the first life, that the way the life continues through this coupling and marriage, through this sexual interactions between man and woman, between with this all of the systems of the eggs, the sperms, and all of the technical details, it's all Allah Azza wa Jal made them available, but made them available for you so that you know that you will be responsible for your deeds and your acts. وَأَنَّ سَعْيَهُ سَوْفَ يُرَى, and your acts and your deeds are going to be visible and going to be inspected and going to be accounted for. And then وَأَنَّ عَلَيْهِ النَّشْأَةَ الْأُخْرَى means that the next life after, Allah Azza wa Jal will do it. He's the only one who is capable of bringing you back to this life, or to the second life, to the life after, where the life of the accountability, if you will. And then وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ أَغْنَى وَأَقْنَى, and it's the same Rabb, it's the same Allah, it's the same God, it's the same one to whom everything ends. وَأَنَّ إِلَى رَبِّكَ الْمُنْتَهَى, the same one who makes people laugh or cry, the same one who gives life and death, the same one who created the couples, the same one who is going to recreate the second life and resurrect the people and bring them from death into the next one. It's the same one who أَغْنَى وَأَقْنَى, is the one that gives people the richness that makes you rich. أَغْنَى means it doesn't have to be the rich with lots of wealth or wealthy, but الْغِنَى, it means to be satisfied so that your needs are satisfied. So you don't need other people or other entities to furnish you, or to feed you, or to give you your houses, your health, your food, your drinks, etc. It's Allah Azza wa Jal who أغنى, وأقنى. أغنى means he gives you something that makes you satisfied. It's not little. وأقنى, أقنى means he enables you to own. I give you something and I allow you to own it. It's not something I give you a piece of the cake and the second piece is in my hand. Or I give you a rope and I continue to hold the rope so I can take it any time I want. No. He says, I'm the one, or Allah Azza wa Jal, he gives and he makes you own what he gives you. It's yours. Enjoy it. Use it. But use it based on the truth. And this is Ayah 48 comes in contrast with the Ayah number 34, which says, وَأَعْطَى قَلِيلًا وَأَكْدَى. This surah is full of these contrasts between the one who follows the wahi and the revelation from Allah Azza wa Jal, or the one who turns his back away. The one who gives little, like those elites, they claim that they give people money. And I was watching the other day some documentaries about tyrants who would use this technique of giving people something relatively, it sounds as it's big, but it's really little, and then they hold back. They make sure that they can take away whatever they give you. So you will remain enslaved in a very humiliating manner. That's وَأَعْطَى قَلِيلًا وَأَكْدَى. He gives you something little and he makes you live in hardship. أَكْدَى coming from the word كَد. It becomes so hard. This little that you take from, especially I'm addressing now, especially some of those who really make fatwas for the rulers, those who sell their deen for a few dollars or a few bucks in order to get something. Yes, the king or the president or this government or this tyrant will give you something, but he will make you suffer for that. أعطى قليلا وأكدى. He gives you a little and make you suffer because of what he gave you. In ayah number 48, which we are talking about, وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ أَغْنَى وَأَقْنَى. This contrast. Allah Azza wa Jal, he gives you something abundant. He gives you abundance of wealth, abundance of things that you need. وَأَقْنَى. وَأَقْنَى, not أَكْدَى. أَقْنَى means he allows you to own that. It's yours. It's yours. Just take it. It's yours. This is your house. This is your money. This is your wealth. This is your rizq. I'm giving to you. Now, the only thing I want you to remember that at the end of the ends, I'm going to hold you responsible for that. But as once I give it to you, I'm not taking it back. وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ أَغْنَى وَأَقْنَى. On the other one, وَأَنَّهُ أَعْطَى قَلِيلًا أَعْطَى قَلِيلًا وَأَكْدَى. He gives little and he makes you suffer for that little. No matter how much you think someone gave you $1 million, but with that $1 million, you destroyed an entire nation, entire ummah. And then that tyrant, at some point of time, he will make you suffer for what you have done, whether psychologically, whether financially, whether materially, and quite often, you may end up even being persecuted or executed by the same tyrant who gave you that. أَعْطَى قَلِيلًا وَأَكْدَى. Here Allah Azza wa Jal, وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ أَغْنَى وَأَقْنَى. وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ رَبُّ الشِّعْرَى. This is an interesting ayah. And this Allah that we are talking about is the same one. He is the Rabb of Ash-Shi'ra. Ash-Shi'ra is a star. Is one of the stars in these galaxies. Very well known to the people of the desert, especially in Arabia. And they use that star, Ash-Shi'ra, as a guidance to their as a guidance to in their trips, in their journeys in the desert. And that's in fact the notion at the beginning of the surah, وَأَن نَجْمِ إِذَا هَوَى. Even this najm, the star, ash-shi'ra that you are following, it will collapse, it will fall. وَإِذَا النُّجُومُ كَدَرَتْ. There is a surah in the Quran that talks about this collapse of the universe. All of the sky will collapse, the stars will fall down, and النجوم كدرت, including الشعرة. And Allah is continues to talk رب الشعرة. Of course, Allah is the Rabb of everything, رب العالمين. Allah is the Rabb of all the worlds, all the stars, all the galaxies. all the universe, whether this current universe that we live in or any further extension to this universe, as Allah Azza wa Jal, He says that He is capable of extending this universe. Inna khalaqna as-samaa wa inna lamusi'un. We created all of this heavens, the skies, and we can extend it. Whether this world or the world to come or the world that was, whether the world of people or the world of animals or the world of the jinn or the worlds of the malaika or the world, all these worlds, Allah Rabbul Alameen. He's not only Rabbu Shara, but here in particular, Allah is picking this one. He says, I am Rabbu Shara. I am the one who give and enable you to own. I am the one who creates the male and female gender so that you can enjoy it and you can continue your life. I am the one to whom everything ends to me. I am. He's bringing all of these issues because each and every one of them has a specific meaning to the people of Quraysh at that time. These ayat, when you look at them, وَأَنَّ عَلَيْهِ وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ. It is He who. It is He who. It is He who. It is He the one who did. It's He the one who created. This, because each and every one of them was a point of argument, dispute, struggle, or an interface, point of contact between Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the rising Ummah of Islam and the Mushrikeen. So this gives me a view of whenever I conduct or I carry this da'wah to Islam in today's time, I have to look at this contrast between what I am about and what the society is about, or what the elites of the society are about, and I have to address these issues and to make sure that whatever I have is superior. The tyrants give little and make people suffer. Islam give abundance and make people happy. You follow the star. You follow a star called Ash-Shara. Allah is Rabbu Shara. Or here, you follow your whims and your wishy-washy thoughts or desires. Allah is the one who created these desires. So you better worship Allah Azza wa Jal. You follow tyrants. But these tyrants are the ones who make you in very hardship at the end of the day. Allah Azza wa Jal, eventually, if He ever makes you live in hardship, especially in the hereafter, it's eternal. That's it. You cannot go back. But here, with the tyrants, you can go back. You can retreat from them. You can get away from all of this garbage that they have. وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ رَبُّ الشَّعْرَ وَأَنَّهُ أَهْلَكَ عَادَنَا الْأُولَى. That's important. See, Allah continues this describing, talking about who this Rabb is. He's أَغْنَى وَأَقْنَى, gives wealth and makes you your own. وَأَنَّهُ رَبُّ الشَّعْرَ, He's the Rabb of Shara, that the star or the stars that you worship and you follow and you take your guidance from them. وَأَنَّهُ أهلك عادا الأولى. He is the one who eliminated the people of عاد. The first عاد, عاد الأولى, because عاد have in the history there are two tribes of عاد or two eras for عاد. The first era of عاد that was eliminated and destroyed and taken away from their rulership, from their authorities, from their atrocities, from their tyranny. Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who took them. And that is a hint or a clue for the people of Mecca on one side and the Muslims on the other side. For the people of Mecca and Quraysh to be aware that this is the same Rabb that you are being invited to worship is the one that has the capability of eliminating entire nations or people, no matter how big they are. Because Ad, as Allah Azza wa Jal talked about them, إِرَمَ ذَاتِ الْعِمَادِ الَّتِي لَمْ يُخْلَقْ مِثْلُهَا فِي الْبِلَادِ. This is Ad, was very, very powerful nation. It's not here bringing it, it's not only for historical meaning, no, but in the Quran Allah says this is a nation, it's an ummah that had not been replicated in the history of mankind. لم يخلق مثلها في البلاد. No other nations had been created or had existed anywhere in the world. And so the people of Mecca, don't think of yourself as being strong or big. And today, I will stand up here and pause for a second and say, look, they are talking about world order and America wants to make the whole world fall down to their knees and to follow the American style, the American life. Biden was mentioning a few days ago, America is the greatest nation, greatest power in the world. No one should fool with America. No one should be can point their fingers and insult us or talk negative about us or fight us. No one can stand in front of us. Oh, wait a second. Here is Allah Azza wa Jal says, look, وَأَنَّهُ أَهَلَكَ عَادًا الْأُولَى. It's Allah Azza wa Jal, the Rabb that you are standing up against, the Rabb that you are trying to suppress every call through yourself, your power and your agents to bring this Islam, this deen back to existence. This Rabb that you are challenging is the one that removed and destroyed and eliminated nations who were stronger than you are. أَهَلَكَ عَادًا الْأُولَى وَثَمُودَ فَمَا أَبْقَى. Not only Ad and Thamud, and did not leave any traces behind them. All of this is gone. All you could see is that there is a place where the people of Ad used to live, a place where Thamud, but there is no history for them. There is no no elements that reminds the people with these tribes or these nations. And then وقوم نوح also. So here Allah Azza wa Jal bringing these Ad, وثمود, ونوح. Quite often in the Quran they are repeated, either the three together or Ad and Thamud alone, and Fir'aun in other places, like in Surah Al-Fajr, where it says, أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ بِعَادِ إِرَمَ ذَاتَ الْعِمَادِ الَّتِي لَمْ يُخْلَقْ مِثْلُهَا فِي الْبِلَادِ وَثَمُودَ الَّذِينَ جَابُوا الصَّخْرَ بِالْوَادِ وَفِرْعَوْنَ ذِي الْأَوْتَادِ. Keeps bringing these issues to Quraysh so they could make a note so that they will not continue their tyranny. And by the same token, today I stand up here and say, look, world order, America, Russia, China, Britain, France, with your tyranny, with your atrocities, thinking that you will be sustained forever as being the ultimate power in this world. No way. No way. Look, the Rabb that we are worshipping, Allah Azza wa Jal, is the one who has the final say in this world and in the hereafter. Because the notion here about أَهْلَكَ عَادًا الْأُولَى, he eliminated, he made collapse the people of Ad, وَثَمُود, and did not leave any trace behind them. This and وَقَوْمَ نُوح, this notion is for things that will happen in this life, not in the hereafter. In the hereafter, it will be the responsibilities in front of Allah Azza wa Jal for final Jannah or final Jahannam or for hellfire. But in this world, Allah Azza wa Jal will not allow tyranny to prevail. Tyranny will not prevail. Oppression will not prevail and will not be sustained. Ungodly work and deeds and systems will not be sustained, will not prevail, will not continue to exist. They are not eternal and they will collapse. And today in front of our eyes, we see the step-by-step collapse of nations. We are seeing the demolishing of the, we have seen the demolishing of socialism and communism and Soviet Union, which once one day was claimed to be the most powerful nation in the world, together with the United States. We see how the United States is facing lots of problems, internally, financial problems. They are printing trillions of dollars to save their own lives and their economy. It will not work. Tyranny does not pay. Tyranny does not stay. Tyranny is going to vanish. And this is what Allah Azza wa Jal is telling us here and telling Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his Sahaba in this Surah An Najm, and telling Quraysh, the ones who were standing up in front of Muhammad alayhi salatu wa sallam, challenging him, arguing against him, character assassinating him, trying to eliminate him, and trying to, and actually suppressing and torturing his Sahaba and killing some of them, that will not pay. That will not pay. That will not be sustained. It is Allah. Again, and these, the sequence of quick ayat, أَنَّا عَلَيْهِ النَّشْأَةَ الْأُخْرَى وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ أَغْنَى وَأَقْنَى وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ رَبُّ الشَّعْرَى وَأَنَّهُ أَهْلَكَ عَدَى الْأُولَى وَثَمُودَ فَمَا أَبْقَى and then وَالْمُؤْتَفِكَةَ أَهْوَى. المؤتفكة is, it's a very general name, and that's where, because some brothers or sisters would say, brother, why are you bringing United States and Russia and Britain and France in these? This is talking about Quraysh 1400 years ago. There were the Persians and the Romans. What is, why you keep bringing this issue? Ayah number 53. Allah Azza wa Jal gives this general term, al-mu'tafika, from the word ifk. Ifk means lie. Ifk means fraud, means forging, means counterfeiting, means deception, means lies, means fabrication. So those, the fabricator, al-mu'tafika, the forgers, the frauders, the liars, the ones who make up things and claim that they are justice, or they are supreme, like white supremacy, American supremacy, white man supremacy. All of these are the lies, the fabrications. Al-Mu'tafika, if it applies to each and every entity in the world, similar to what Ad did, to what Thamud did, to what Qawm Nuh did, to what Quraysh did, to what the Persians at the time did, what the Romans did, what the Mushrikeen did, and today it applies to the what America is doing in Afghanistan, in Iraq, in Libya, in Syria, killing millions of people, evicting them out of their homes, and recruiting Russia and the militias of Hezbollah in Syria, and in the Houthis in Yemen, and the Saudis and the Emiratis, etc., recruiting all types of powers and atrocities, giving them money and giving them wealth and giving them weapons in order to bring the people to worship this America. It applies to them. This ayah applies to all. وَالْمُؤْتَفِكَةَ أَهْوَى. All the fabricators, all the wrongdoers, all the those who claim authority other than Allah Azza wa Jal will fall. And Allah is using the word ahwa. It's very interesting. Look at the first ayah in Surah An-Najm. And when you look at these, the repetition of the words in different terms, you find the miraculous part of the Quran. This tafsir is not about the how miraculous is the Quran, but sometimes these words, they just stand up in front of you, so you better mention it. At the beginning, when najmi idha hawa, the najm hawa means falls down and collapse. Here Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَالْمُؤْتَفِكَةَ أَهْوَى. Allah makes al-mu'tafika, the fabricators, fall down. When Allah pushes the fabricator and the wrongdoer and the ones who claim authority other than Allah Azza wa Jal, pushes them from their highest level, because ahwa means you push someone from a height to go down, because falling down and collapsing, like a najm that falls and collapses from the highest possible level in the heavens, that's where the stars are, it collapses and sky dives down. And al-mu'tafika here, when he says ahwa, it means these fabricators, these wrongdoers, these tyrants of the world, these big powers, these world order maintainers, supposedly, they are in their highest positions. They think that no one is beyond us, no one is greater than us, no one can bring us down. We are absolutely powerful. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, these are the ones that I make fall. It's not a tiny little nation which could fall, which could collapse, but it's not even worth talking about it. Allah Azza wa Jalla is talking about here al-Mu'tafika, the ones who assume highest possible positions, like Ad, لم يخلق مثلها في البلاد. He's talking about these tyrants who think of themselves so big that no one can come close to us, like Fir'aun, the Pharaoh, where he used to say, أنا ربكم الأعلى. I am your highest Rabb. And asking Bani Israel and others, have you known any Rabb, any God other than me who's worthy of worship? I am the one who built the pyramids. I am the one who can make life and death. I am the one who can make this. I am the one who can make that. I am the one who has the wealth. I am all of this. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, okay, I'll show you. Then he takes him down from his height, takes him down from the position he puts himself in. Takes Ayah, takes Thamud, takes Nuh, takes Qawm Nuh, takes Fir'aun, takes Quraysh, takes the Persians, takes the Romans, and today it takes Al-Mu'tafika, which applies to America, Britain, France, China, Russia, the ones who commit atrocities against all humanities, not only Muslims. China is not committing atrocities against the Rohingya in China. They are committing atrocities against their own people. America is not only committing atrocities against the Muslims in Syria and in Iraq and in Libya and in Yemen and in Afghanistan. America is committing atrocities against their own people inside America. Same thing as Russia, same thing as Britain, as France, who have France had consumed millions of lives of Algeria until today is not even regretting that they have done that. Britain had done so millions of atrocities, millions of people were killed in Africa for the very reason that Britain and France were colonialists there and they wanted to sustain their colonialism. So they made the tribes, they armed the tribes and they provoked them to fight one another under the rulership and the guidance of Britain and France and America. These atrocities will not go unnoticed. Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَالْمُؤْتَفِكَةَ أَهْوَى. It is Allah, it's the Rabb of Ash-Shu'ara, it's the Rabb who vanished Aad al-Ula and vanished Thamud and vanished the people of Nuh. He's the one who brings life and death. He's the one who makes happiness and the one who makes sadness. He's all of these. This Allah, and we talked about previously about him, Al-Ahad Al-Samad, لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ. He's Rabb al-Nas, Malik al-Nas, Rabb al-Falaq. All of these, this is Allah, this is the one who will make this happen. And then he talks, فَغَشَّاهَا مَا غَشَّى. All of this, like Al-Mu'tafika, when Allah Azza wa Jal makes it collapse, he will wrap it up in a manner that Allah chooses. فَغَشَّاهَا مَا غَشَّى. غَشَّى from the word غِشَاء. غِشَاء means something to wrap things with, like in the womb of the mother. When the baby is there, he will be wrapped in a bag with tissues. That's called ghisha. Ghisha means wrapping something or wrapping the issue here in whatever he wants. So he says, "Wal mu'tafikata ahwa." This mu'tafika, these fabricators, will cause them to collapse and to fall, and Allah Azza wa Jal will use whatever means he has to cover and wrap all of these things and throw it in the garbage of history. Actually, not in the garbage of history, but in the heat of Jahannam. And then finally here switches to address now directly, فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكَ تَتَمَارَى. After all of this, what any of these ala or signs of Allah you are going to argue against or to protest or to deny? Which one? Choose anyone. You want to argue about Ad and Thamud? You want to argue about who makes life and death? You want to argue about who is going to bring the people back into life one more time? You are going to argue about the ability of Allah Azza wa Jal to destroy Al-Mu'tafika, the fabricators and the wrongdoers and the tyrants? Which one? فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكَ تَتَمَارَى. Just choose. Give me one. Of course, no answer here. Allah Azza wa Jal does not wait for the people to answer and say, oh, you know what? I have an issue with, everything is fine, but I have an issue with the Mu'tafika. Let's talk about it. Allah does not give you even a chance to take your breath and ponder on this issue and try to respond back. These are like knocks and knock is knocking at your brain, knocking at your head, knocking at your heart, knocking at your feelings, so that it provokes each and every aspect of your life, of your body, of your entity as a human, in order to really be amazed and astonished with all of these sequence and terrain of ayat coming one after another, starting from وَأَنَّهُ وَأَنَّ إِلَى رَبِّكَ الْمُنْتَهَى وَأَنَّهُ أَضْحَكَ وَأَبْكَى وَأَنَّهُ أَمَاتَ وَأَحْيَى وَأَنَّهُ خَلَقَ الزَّوْجَيْنِ الذَّكَرَ وَالْأُنْثَى مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ إِذَا تُمْنَى وَأَنَّ عَلَيْهِ النَّشْأَةَ الْأُخْرَى وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ أَغْنَى وَأَقْنَى وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ رَبُّ الشِّعْرَى وَأَنَّهُ أَهْلَكَ عَادًا الْأُولَى وَأَن وَثَمُودَ فَمَا أَبْقَى وَقَوْمَ نُوحٍ مِنْ قَبْلُ إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا هُمْ أَظْلَمَ وَأَطْغَى وَالْمُؤْتَفِكَةَ أَهْوَى فَغَشَّاهَا مَا غَشَّاهَا. Stop after all of these. How many ayahs starting from ayah 42 until ayah 54, 12 ayat, one after another, quick, fast, very short, then stop, tell me which one you are going to deny. فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكَ تَتَمَارَى. Tell me, what is it that you want to argue about? Are you going to be eternal? Are you going to be the first, the one who can make people happy or make them cry at any point of time you want? Do you think you can continue to give, and so that the people can own, instead of having the largest sum of money which was printed in the last year or so went to less than 1% of the trillionaires or billionaires? Can you give up this stupid life of yours? فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكَ تَتَمَارَى. You have no choice, no chance, no time even to respond. هَذَا نَذِيرٌ مِنَ النُّذُرِ الْأُولَى. This is one sign of warning. This is the first warning. النُّذُرِ الْأُولَى, it has many meaning. Some Mufassirin, they say this is the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who is called An-Nadhir. He is a Nadhir. He is a warner. He's warning people about what's awaiting them, just like the ones who preceded him, like Nuh alayhi salam, like Hud alayhi salam, like Isa, like Musa. Or this is just a beginning of another. There's just one. هذا نذير. This is a warning. It's a big alarm and more alarms to follow. من النذر الأولى, this one of the earlier warning coming to the people of Quraysh and the people of the world. This is just the start. Wait until you see the end, whenever this nadir becomes a reality in your life. And then here Allah Azza wa Jal is bringing the issue, azifat al-azifa. Look. Azifa, it means come close. This is something is coming closer. It's about to happen. Azifat al-azifa, it means it's about to happen. This is not something that's going to be too remote. Because whatever sounds remote to you, you are coming closer to it by the day. Every minute you spend in your life, you are getting closer to the end that Allah Azza wa Jal talked about, وَأَنَّ إِلَى رَبِّكَ الْمُنْتَهَى. The end goes up to Allah Azza wa Jal. That end, every minute you spend in your life, now we have been here since for almost an hour. We are about to finish, brother. give me a few minutes and I will finish. We have been here for almost an hour. This hour, from the time we started, we came closer 1 hour to this azifa, to the thing that Allah Azza wa Jal is talking about. Azifatul azifa means the thing that you are talking about, this is the issue that's coming up, it's getting closer. Azifatul azifa. And this statement in the same manner, with the same wording, was used in another surah. And in the next surah, Surah Al-Qamar, the next surah in the order of Quran, not in the order of Revelation, Allah Azza wa Jal begins, اقتربت الساعة وانشق القمر. Just these are the last five ayat in the surah. Allah, and then surah, right after these, immediately in Surah Al-Qamar, says اقتربت الساعة, the hour which you are awaiting for, the hour of accountability, the hour that everything goes up to Allah Azza wa Jal, is coming closer. It's getting closer. أزفت الأزفة ليس لها من دون الله كاشفة. Don't think that it will ever be eliminated, this أزفة. Don't ever think that it will not come. Don't ever even a glimpse of thought in your brain that, oh, we are going to be eternal, or to forget about this azifa. It's coming, and it's going to open up. Kashifa means the one that that reveals realities, because today we may hide realities as individuals, we may hide realities behind the scene as nations, as conspiracies. Talk about conspiracy. What's conspiracy? Conspiracy, this is a plan, it's a plot that's done behind the scenes. Conspiracy is not something fake, because America tries to let the people know that, look, whenever you say it's conspiracy theory, it's something fake, something imaginary. Conspiracy is not imaginary. Conspiracy is a reality behind the scene. It's a covert operation, another place called. Those covert operations, covert deeds. Covert means covered, not seen. They will be revealed. They will be uncovered. Kashifa. Kashifa means it opens up everything in the open. So nothing will be hidden. This azifa that's coming soon, which is the accountability, nothing will stop it from coming, and from where the deeds and the sa'i, remember the ayah that came earlier, وَأَنْ لَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى. A human has only whatever deeds he has done. Those, nothing can hide them, because this اليوم الآخر, in fact, this is one of the names that's given to the Day of Judgment, Al-Kashifa, like Al-Qari'ah, like Al-Haqqa, like Al-Waqi'ah. All of these are names that were given to this Day of Judgment, to this final day. Each and every one provides a specific view, if you will, visualization of what day is. Like Al-Qari'ah, it visualizes something that really knocks down on this world, that brings this absolutely astonishing voice and sound that makes everybody almost lose his conscience. Al-Qari'ah. Al-Haqqa, the one that brings Al-Haqq. Al-Waqi'ah, the one that's real, that's absolutely real. And here Al-Kashifa, the one that reveals everything, and no one can stop that, because Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who makes it, who makes the order for all of these deeds to be revealed. And then now, here is the final ayat. Pause a second and makes a question. Allah gives a question now. All of these were facts. Giving facts, facts, facts. Now, أَفَمِنْ هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ تَعْجَبُونَ. Are you really surprised and wondering about this talk? You're just saying, what the heck is going on? What is this man talking about? What is this surah is trying to tell us? And you are just opening your eyes in an amusement, because تعجبون here, it's not surprise, but an amusement. أفهم هذا تعجبون, you're being amused. وتضحكون ولا تبكون, you are laughing and you are not crying. You should be crying. You should be, you should feel sad. You should feel astonished, not because this is something strange that's being talked to you. You should be astonished because you may be the subject of all of these disasters that will come one day. And you have to pay for that. And nothing can mediate between you and Allah Azza wa Jal. Not al-shara, not al-gharadiq. This is another issue that I will mention in a few seconds. Are you really in your minds? Have you lost your brains, your senses? You are sitting there being amused and laughing at this man, at this surah that's being read to your brains, to your minds, if you have any, or to your ears at least. وَأَنْتُمْ سَامِدُونَ, you are just relaxing as if nothing is happening. Have you lost your minds? Is this how you should approach or respond to this type of surah and these ayat that are coming to you with all types of meanings and miraculous way of presenting these issues? What you should do, فَاسْجُدُوا لِلَّهِ, bow down to Allah Azza wa Jal. Stop being ridiculous. Stop being ignorant. Stop being like babies who only can either cry or play based on what you give them, based on candies. Stop being so absolutely irrelevant, or pretending that this does not concern you. Stop playing games. It's not a game, it's serious. Bow down and worship. فَاسْجُدُوا لِلَّهِ وَاعْبُدُوا. And here, the ayah is very interesting. اسْجُدُوا means make sujood to Allah Azza wa Jal now. And the word fa in Arabic, look at the previous وَأَنْتُمْ wow, وَلَا تَبْكُونَ wow, وَتَضْحَكُونَ wow. Whenever in Arabic says wow, means there could be a time gap, a second, 2 seconds, 5 seconds, minute doing that. But when it talks fa, it means immediate. فَاسْجُدُوا now. He's ordering فَاسْجُدُوا لِلَّهِ, make sujood down to Allah Azza wa Jal now. Now وَعْبُدُوا and worship. Now he did not say worship Allah Azza wa Jal. Look, he could have said wa'buduh with an H. Wa'buduh means worship him, which is Allah Azza wa Jal. Or wa'budullah. Interesting, here he just said wa'buduh. Fasjudu lillahi wa'buduh. The sujood here, bow down, make sujood to the glory and to the greatness and to the power and to the meanings and to this very strong meaning that this ayat carry. Make sujood not because you worship Allah Azza wa Jal, but because you have been spotted in a very weak spot. You have no choice but to bow down, whether you believe or not believe, whether you accept or not accept. Because I have just said here, Allah Azza wa Jal said, I've just noticed and told you, I see you, I watch you. You are playing, you are laughing, you are not even taking anything serious, you are relaxing, you are being amused. So you are way far away from being worshipper to Allah Azza wa Jal. But I want you to bow down as much as the Muslims do. This ayah or this fasjudu, when you are reading it in the prayer, in the salah, or even in the Quran, you have to make sujood. This is one of the ayat that has sujood. And the Muslims, when they heard this at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they all made sujood. Now, the people of Quraysh, including Al-Walid bin Mughira, including Abu Jahl, including the top elites, they fell down on the ground. Here it's an order to do in a manner that you cannot resent. It's in a manner that you cannot resent, no matter what the status, the mental status you have currently. No matter how much in denial you are, no matter how much in opposition you are to this deen, you have to admit the power of these ayat. You have to admit the power of Allah Azza wa Jal and bow down. Come down to the ground. And then worship. Now worship, it's left without specifying whom, because that requires belief. That requires belief. A sujood does not require belief. It requires to confess and to understand he is in front of something very, very powerful, in front of something beyond his ability to comprehend. It's he is in front of a giant. Like Islam. Now, of course, Allah Azza wa Jal is great. He's in front of something absolutely great beyond his ability to refuse the order, the physical order. But belief and worship is a mental. It requires conviction here. It requires satisfaction here in the heart. Your brain, your mind should be convinced. Your heart should echo your belief and becomes all as one. Your heart and mind, they become one in worshiping, in believing in Allah Azza wa Jal, in understanding his greatness, in believing in his existence, in his eternality, in all of these issues that he talked about. Now I continue believe, then I will worship Allah Azza wa Jal. So Allah Azza wa Jal does not play games. Allah does not force people to do especially things which have to do with a belief. وَلَوْ يَشَاءُ اللَّهُ لَجَعَلَ النَّاسَ أُمَّةً وَاحِدًا. If Allah Azza wa Jal wanted, he could have made all the people one ummah, one belief. They all believe just like the angels. He did them worshippers of Allah Azza wa Jal without any objection. There is no problem for Allah Azza wa Jal. He can do that. But for the people, he chose that you have to be responsible for your belief and worship. So this ayah, it ends up this surah with this very great notion and this hint for anyone who sometimes think, oh, what is so miraculous about the Quran? What is so big about the Quran? It's just Arabic. See, look, when with those whole surah, the 62 ayat, and then the last one, it's... It just comes in a manner that many people who read that will say, oh, why didn't Allah Azza wa Jalla says wa'buduhu? Oh, it means the same thing. But no, it doesn't mean the same thing. Fasjudu lillah, sujud for Allah Azza wa Jalla, because he is great, he created you. Whether you like it or not, you will make sujood. And they did. And they did. And the Muslims knew that these people, they fell down on the ground out of their helplessness in front of these in this terrain of ayat. But wa'budu, now choose your own God to worship. Choose, you want to continue worship your idols, do it, and I will meet you at the end of this world, and I will see how I'm going to deal with you. You want to worship Allah Azza wa Jal, this is the path to Allah Azza wa Jal. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Quran and the ayat, this is the path. This is al-huda. This is al-wahi. You follow that. In summary, these 62 ayat in Surah An Najm, which the largest ayah that came as in size was ayah number 32, that even it says 1, 2, 3, almost two lines of words, larger than the largest ayah. Most of the other ayats are few words only. Even some of the Mufassirin, they thought that this Ayah 32 was revealed in Medina, because it's unlikely to be revealed in Mecca together with these terrains of Ayat. But nevertheless, this surah with 62 Ayat, most of them, the vast majority of them, are short. They are precise. It had talked about so many issues, about guidance, to whom belongs, to Allah Azza wa Jal, not to any star, no matter what that star is. Could be the physical star in the sky, could be the stars of the people who make them stars, like they talk the movie stars, the sports star, king star, presidents, elites, congress people, all of this type of stars, they make them elites. Guidance does not belong there, it belongs to Allah Azza wa Jal. Eventually, at the end of the day, everything goes back to Allah Azza wa Jal. So you better be careful. If you think you are tyrant, too big to fall, think of Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who vanished, who caused to vanish Aad wa Thamud wa Fir'aun wa Qawm Nuh. And eventually he said, look, and all the ones, the opposers, the fabricators, the ones who deny the right of Islam or the message of Allah Azza wa Jal to be the dominant ones in the life of people. And I will stop right here. And this is the end of the surah. Next time we'll see you inshallah with a new surah in the order of revelation. Assalamu alaikum, jazakallahu khair. And if there are any questions, let's go on and take these questions. Okay, first question comes from brother Abu Bilal. Not relevant, Taha. But 14 August is celebrated in Pakistan as Day of Independence. What message would you give to people of subcontinent? Well, number one, it's independence from the rules of Allah Azza wa Jal. Although Pakistan was created on the basis that to be a Muslim or Islamic country, where India is a Hindu country, they claimed that this is the base upon which they will split from India, Pakistan and Bangladesh as well, which used to be called the Eastern Pakistan. But then they ended up falling in the same path as India does, which is secularism and civil state and all of this garbage. So this independence is actually independence from the rules of Allah Azza wa Jal. It is haram to celebrate. It's haram to keep it as an honorable day. People should resent that, should revolt against that, and should bring back the dependence on Allah Azza wa Jal. We want to be dependent on Allah, but independent of everything that's kufr, everything that's shirk, everything that's non-Islamic, we have to be independent of that. Unfortunately, today, Pakistan, as well as Bangladesh, as well as Indonesia, as well as Egypt, Turkey, Algeria, Morocco, what have you, all of them, they all celebrate the independence from the rules of Allah Azza wa Jal. Unfortunately, they have to go back and celebrate and to build the rules, the atmosphere for the rules of Islam to prevail, and then you will celebrate that day. وَيَوْمَ إِذٍ يَفْرَحُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ بِنَصْرِ اللَّهِ. Like what the ayah in Surah Al-Rum said, غُلِبَتُ الرُّومُ فِي أَدْنَى الْأَرْضِ وَهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ غَلَبِهِمْ سَيَغْلِبُونَ فِي بِضْعِ سِنِينَ لِلَّهِ الْأَمْرُ مِنْ قَبْلُ وَمِنْ بَعْدِ وَيَوْمَ إِذِي يَفْرَحُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. And then only the believers will celebrate, will be happy. Now, of course, Allah does not talk about the victory of the Romans against the Persians. He's talking about a victory of the Muslims that will happen, which will make them happy. So today, that's what I would say to these people, although it is in line with this surah, with the people who really think of themselves as gods, as tyrants. أَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي كَذَّبَ وَتَوَلَّى. The ones who deny and they run away from Islam. Pakistani rulers as well as all the Muslim rulers, they run away from Islam. Not only run away, but they suppress it, exactly like the people of Quraysh. But we tell them, as the Surah An Najm says, Azifatul Azifa. Time is coming close, whether you like it or not. It's getting closer and closer. Not only the day of judgment, but the time of victory is coming closer. The time of the prevalence of Islam is coming closer. The time of the authority of Islam coming back is coming closer. Azifat al-azifa. It's coming. It's right next door. It's knocking at the door. It's no longer hidden. It's like al-kashifa, like the one that Allah Azza wa Jal talks about. Laysa laha min dunillahi kashifa. There is nothing that can keep this hidden and away from the people. It's coming. As much as in the day, on the day of judgment, it will come, the accountability. In this life, the prevalence of Islam and the Islamic rules and the prevalence of the Islamic khilafah, if you will, it is coming. Azifat al-azifa. Laysa laha min dunillahi kashifa. Nothing will prevent that from happening. So to the people of Pakistan and the rest of the Muslims in the world, take note. Take note of that. And we tell them, أَفَ مِنْ هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ يَعْجَبُونَ. Don't be amused. Don't think, look, this brother like Abu Talha and a few brothers here listening to him at the end of the night, at the middle of night, these guys are really out of it. They are dreaming. It's not coming. And they start amusing themselves. Look at these dreamers. أَفَ مِنْ هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ يَعْجَبُونَ. You think this is amusement? This is a reason for you to laugh? You should be crying because your life is ending. Your tyranny is ending. Your systems is ending. Your capitalism is falling. Your democracy is going away. Your nationalism is being crashed. Your money is being trashed. Don't laugh. Don't laugh. Don't celebrate tyranny. Stop celebrating oppression. Stop celebrating falsehood. Stop celebrating ideas and thoughts and ideologies which stand against Allah Azza wa Jal and against the rules of Allah. Stop doing that. وَأَنْتُمْ سَامِدُونَ. Don't do that. A summary session for this surah. I think I tried to summarize it in this talk, but let me go with you, Sister Bint Adam. I will make the next session, because this surah took 6 parts. Probably we have forgotten part of it. So let's do the next surah, inshallah. And this is a reminder to Brother Faizan and the sister who is running this event, that next time I will make a summary of Surah An-Najm and put it in context with the surahs that were revealed before and with the next surah that we will be talking about, inshallah. Okay, thank you, sister. Okay, جزاكم الله خيرا, and inshallah we'll see you next week. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.